case-based discussion on the risk stratification on acute coronary syndromes. Acute coronary syndromes, when patient present was with the acute chest pain, and in that chest pain we have differential diagnosis of unstable angina, NSTMI, and acute ST segment 11. Apart from this, these are the acute coronary syndromes. Apart from these, we have the new onset exceptional angina also, or it may be the progressive angina also, or maybe the atypical angina, rest pain without any ECG changes, or rest pain with ECG changes and rest pain plus troponin positive. So there is a spectrum of the chest pain. It may be the non-cardiac, it may be the unstable angina, other cardiac condition like the pericarditis or the, and it may be the NSTMI or STMI. Now first, risk stratification for STMI. That is a general protocol. One patient comes to us, we do first ECG, and in ECG, if there is an ECG finding of ST elevation MI as per definition, if there is a more than 1.5 mm, and it is age up, as per the age in the 40-45 years old, and it is more than 2 mm in the young males. So as per classification, if the patient splits into the STMI, then we can further risk assessment of that patient according to protocol of STMI or the scores which are specific for ST elevation MI. Now here is the first case. The 44 years old male presented to us with a chest pain for 3 hours. Heart rate was 90 per minute, respiratory rate was 14 per minute, and respiration system was bilateral and no crepitation. BP 110 by 70. Here we can see in the ECG, patient has posterolateral involvement or the true posterior kind of MI. L1, we can see the ST elevation in the L1 and the reciprocal ST depression in the V2, V3. We are going to discuss these all cases later on. There was a case, so these are all the
Which MI was there?
Sir, there is the involvement of the lateral part along with the posterior segment involvement. So
you are expecting diagonal?
No sir, less likely diagonal. Means L1 ST elevation in L1 is also, so either OM, either diagonal.
One and LEL, there was LEL.
Can you rule out vasospasm? How? What is the change or difference?
Sir, vasospasm, there is a transient ST elevation and it is, responding, patient is responding to nitrate. In many cases of vasospasm, patient will respond to nitrate. And while doing, if within 10 minutes the pain will be resolving within 10 to 15 minutes. In rare cases, it may last beyond half an hour. But in that case also, while we do angiography, the angiography will be clear.
There won't be any elevation of troponins.
No sir, it is dependent on, it is a time dependent ischemia. So if there is a prolonged vasospasm, it may lead to ST elevation. Elevation of the troponin. It may lead to elevation of the vasospasm. And that is specific for any drug induced. It means a cocaine induced or any drug induced vasospasm is there, we can see elevation of the troponin.
To the extent we see ST elevation, or it is mild elevation?
Sir?
It's mild elevation of troponin or very high elevation can also be.
It is always depending on the amount of the drug consumed and the timing or the duration of the vasospasm. If vasospasm is short life or the without any drug or primitive factor is anxiety and that kind of thing, in the prismatal angina, ST elevation, biomarker elevation won't be much, but if there is drug induced or any other cause that leads to prolonged vasospasm, 10 to 15 minutes or the chest pain lasting more than 20 minutes, that will be definitely troponin.
Will it ever produce necrosis?
Yes, that can produce necrosis.
That can? Spasms?
Yes sir. Spasm can produce necrosis, that is, duration is the main sir. If the spasm lasting 62 year old male, chest pain for 3 days, heart rate was 124 and respiratory was 32. RS bilateral entry was there. Crepitations are there. BP is 90 by 42 and history of diabetes, hypertension for 10 years. there is an inferior wall MI and there is a reciprocal depression in 1 and AVM. In this patient, RC was involved. Proximal RC was there. Third case, 34-year-old male, chest pain for 6 hours, heart rate 120, 130, respiratory rate 33 per minute. Crepitations was there, VP was 88 by 52. VT on arrival, we had done CPR and the patient was revived after CPR. This was easy. Again, inferior wall MI. But in this patient, we can see there is abnormal, the flutter kind of the rhythm with some variable wrong. Now, the risk stratification, we are primarily discussing these three cases for the risk stratification or the further prognosis of the patient. This occurs at the several stages. First, we can do risk stratification or we can give an idea about prognosis on the admission during hospitalization. That means if we are doing any procedure, after procedure also the risk status will be changing. So, and at or the discharge. High risk acute phase risk stratification or the high risk electrocardiographic features are anterior wall MI and persistent ST elevation. Q wave in the multiple ways. RVMI plus inferior wall MI. Means if there is only inferior wall MI, prognosis is little bit better. But if the RVMI is involved, right side is also involved, the prognosis got not that good. High sum of the ST elevation. The total ST elevation in all ways. The more the degree of the ST elevation, prognosis is more worse. The reciprocal ST depression. If there is an anterior wall MI and if you are finding the reciprocal ST depression in the inferior, that leads the more amount of the myocardium is necrosed or the more amount of the myocardium is damaged. Persisting ST depression, prolonged QT, any conduction defect or the heart wall, and the sinus tachycardia or atrial fibrillation. This is the most commonly used classification, the LEAP classification. There is a primary clinical on arrival. First group of patient has no CHF, there is no changes of the congestive heart failure. This is 30 to 50% of the total patient with STMI, and the mortality in this group is only 5%. The second group is the Rales S3 and pulmonary venous hypertension. We can call this impending CHF, but patient is not in CCM, just impending CHF. 33% of the patient and mortality is 15 to 20%. The third is frank pulmonary edema. CCF is there, frank CCF is there, patient has having dyspnea, SpO2 is somewhat lesser. So frank pulmonary edema, percentage is 15%, mortality is 40%. The last one is the with the cardiogenic shock. In percentage of patient, it is a 10% patient will come in the cardiogenic shock and the mortality is 80 to 100%. The risk score. We are using TIMI GRACE. TIMI score is during admission, on the admission. The GRACE score is at the admission and at the 6 month. Then swallow primary PCI index. Swallow and Cadillac, both score involve the PCI or the procedure. Post-procedure results are involved in those both score. So that give in during hospitalization or the after procedure risk. Then another two is the Goldman and Pursue. We will be primarily discussing first score, TIMI, GRACE, Swallow and Cadillac. TIMI score, the parameters are involved are the age, 65 to 74 or the more than 75 years of age, that is depending on the points. I mean, 65 to 74, that carries the 2 points, and more than 75 years of age, that carries the 3 points. The systolic blood pressure less than 100, heart rate more than 100, Kili class 2 to class 4, anterior STMI or with left bundle branch block. This is freshly developed left bundle branch block. History of diabetes, hypertension, angina. Weight less than 67 and time to treatment more than 4 hours. This is a gradual increase in the mortality. Maximum is if there is a score more than 8, maximum mortality is 17.2% mortality or the 30% survivor. at the 30 day survivors are almost 80%. The another risk index that was
kidney score was at 30 days after surviving 30 days, and then 1 year mortality was this. That is what
actually we are counting TB score on admission, and that predicts the mortality of the 30 day survivor and the 1 year survivor.
So that TB we don't count again at 30 days. Right?
No.
On admission it was.
On admission, TB score is always counted at the time of admission, and that predicts the mortality of survivor. And basically, they have studied fibrinolysis therapy in the TB scale. So they have predicted the result of the fibrinolysis. So TB scale is basically mainly based on the fibrinolysis therapy.
So their percentage for the mortality at 30 days or at 1 year?
This is at the 1 year mortality score and 30 days survival. There is a different chart for this. Yes, this one is the 30 days. Now they have studied another risk index, heart rate, that is the TB risk index, heart rate into age upon 10 square upon systolic blood pressure. This is also independent of the TB score and it is predictor of the mortality 24 hours and 30 days. The risk index mortality. Sir, they don't have cutoff valuation. They are they are providing the graph or it is automated calculator. As per this value, you can predict the magnifier. So we can see the risk index 10 to 20, 20 to 30, 30 to 40. They are dividing like this. So in
higher,
this question,
higher the score, higher the mortality.
Yes.
If the blood pressure is less, the mortality will be less.
So, sir, it is not blood pressure. If blood pressure is less, the score will be high and the mortality will be high. Blood pressure is inverse. Yeah. The another one is the grace risk score. It is
according to that particular formula, ready arrhythmic patient will be invariably having little good prognosis.
Yes. According to that, it is depending on the two factors, bradyarrhythmic with high blood pressure. If bradyarrhythmic with low blood pressure, that score also will be high. The grace risk score, it is used to predict the cumulative risk of the date and date for the myocardial infarction in the period from admission to hospital up to 6 months after discharge. That is an automated calculation model in which we are counting age, heart rate, systolic blood pressure. These all are counted at the time of admission. Systolic blood pressure, serum creatinine and TLIP class. Then at the 6 month at the discharge, or to count the 6 month risk score, we have to add arrest, another condition, it's cardiac arrest at the time of admission, elevated cardiac enzyme and ST elevation deviation. Now post procedure risk scores. The first one is the cardiac risk score. In this baseline LVF, we are counting this after procedure or just before the discharge. So baseline LVF for the after procedure LVF. Renal insufficiency, TLIP class on admission. Then final TB flow, after the procedure TB flow, TB grade 2 or grade 0. Then age more than 65, any anemia, multivessel disease, if there is a 3 vessel disease, and the total points we have. So if there is a score is 0 to 2, the risk will be 0.1 to 0.2 percentage at 30 days and 0.8 to 0.9 at 1 year. Intermediate risk score 3 to 5, 1.3 to 1.9 percentage at 30 days and 4 to 4.5 at 1 year. And the high risk score 6.6 to 8.1 at 30 days and 12.4 to 13.2 at 1 year. There is another post procedure risk score. There is a Zwelle primary index. In this also we are counting the P-class, TIMI flow post procedure, age, 3 vessel disease, anterior infarction and the ischemic time, total time to reperfuse. Score more than 4 are considered as a high risk category. We are going again with the cases. This is the first quiz. In this patient, 44-year-old male, chest pain for duration of the chest pain was the 3 hours, heart rate 90, respiratory rate 40. This patient comes in the PEEP class 1. The BP is stable, there is no sign of congestion, there is no, so mortality is very less according to the PEEP, less than 5%. TIMI score 0, age is not a major factor. Age is not a major factor for this patient. Blood pressure is also okay, heart rate is also okay. So PEEP class is also okay. There is no anterior involvement, diabetes, hypertension, nothing is there. TIMI score gone. TIMI score is the 0. 30 day mortality is 0.8% for this patient. Now, 4-0, 1 year mortality is 1%. Cadillac risk score. For this, we have done the CAG. CAG suggestive of a single vessel disease. PTCA to RCA was done with TIMI 3 flow. And the post procedure LVF was 45%. So the Cadillac risk score and the Zwelle both are 0. So all over, this patient has a very good prognosis. Zwelle square is also almost 0. So low risk. And the Cadillac risk, Cadillac score 0, that is also risk. So 0.1 to 0.2% mortality after procedure. Before procedure, mortality prognosis was around 1% by the TIMI score and another TIMI index. But after procedure, it is 0.1 to 0.2%. Now, second case. This is a 66-year-old male, history of the diabetes, hypertension for 10 years. Crepitations are there. So we can see that is a pulmonary congestion, SpO2 88. So we can classify this as TIMI class 3, 50 to 60% mortality as per the TIMI class. TIMI score 5. TIMI score 5 leads to the, means this patient has age more than 65, blood pressure is okay, heart rate is more than 100, so that is a 2 point, and TIMI class. So the TIMI score is high, that lead to prognosis or the mortality at 30 days 12.4%, 1 year mortality 6.7%. Cadillac risk score. For this patient, we have CAG suggestive of the triple vessel disease and PTCA to dominant LCX, OM done with the TIMI 2 flow. Creatinine was also elevated. So, there is Cadillac risk score was the high, more than 6, suggestive of the 6 to 8% mortality. So, even after procedure, there is no significant reduction in the mortality in this patient. In the Zwelle score, the risk score is more than 4, again suggesting the very high risk. Now, third case, 34-year-old male, chest pain for 2 hours, heart rate 130 and respiratory rate 33 per minute, RS bilateral entry plus crepitation was there, BP is 88 by 52, so suggestive of the cardiogenic shock with congestion, SpO2 86%. So it comes into PEEP class 4, 80 to 100% of mortality. TIMI score 2, because CAG was the SVD, there was primary thrombotic occlusion of the RCA. So PTCA to RCA done with the TIMI 3 flow. And post procedure I get 45%. Sorry. TIMI score age is not that much, BP is less to 0.3 and heart rate is more. Sorry, TIMI score will be around 4 or 5. That is a mistake. Sorry. TIMI score would be around 4 or 5. So on admission, mortality risk will be 12.4. But after procedure, the Cadillac risk score will be intermediate risk score. Because we have good procedure result. So this risk score will be 3 to 5 and leads to intermediate risk of the 1.3 to 1.9 percentage, and with 4 to 4.5 percentage mortality at 1 year. But again, fellow prime PCI index will be more than 4. So there is a somewhat risk reduction in this patient after the procedure due to good procedure result, and prognosis is little bit better than previous patient, case, second case.
So all these are basically pulse rates and not SR response. That is main two things.
Yes, actually
there was the pulse rate and then lower the blood pressure.
Actually yes, that is the on admission criteria, that is the perfect judgment. Means we can prognosis as per the, we can give idea of the prognosis as per the pulse rate or the heart rate, pulse rate or the BP. But the major thing which developed recently or the after this recent score, Cadillac score and this Valor score, we are also depending on the procedure also. If procedure is goes well, there is a single vessel disease or the thrombotic occlusion of the vessel and the reperfusion time is less than 4 hours, all over prognosis and 1 year mortality is less. Even if your first on admission score is very bad, means the prognosis on admission was not good, but after procedure that can be improved if within duration, within specific duration of the time, and if we are getting TV2, TV3 flow, we are getting good flow through the vessels. That will decrease your previous risk. But if time is more, multiple comorbidities and vessels are not good, means if there is a multi-vessel CAD, then your risk is not decreasing even after the procedure.
So will you subject this patient to procedure?
Sir, depending on the my previous lecture, why I did this scan. If we have the enough time window.
So is there any
data?
But you are telling that it will not improve, the risk score will not improve. So would you subject that patient? That is clear cut question.
In acute scenario, you are not going to go for viability.
Exactly. In acute scenario,
so
we have to go for viability.
Then question arises whether in death category, where even after procedure, probably the incidence of mortality is still increasing, what is the mortality ratio even if you don't do procedure? It is even more than you do the procedure? That is what the question is. Is there any data in that score?
Actually, there are multiple studies for that. There is a deeper trial, means in acute STMI, for this specifically this complication, they have studied like not reperfusion, means not doing revascularization during first 24 to 48 hours, because there is a high thrombus load and the vessels are not good at time of the MI. So they are doing either balloon, not stenting, not implanting any stent, either balloon, either thrombolysis. Just keep the vessel open for 24 to 48 hours, and after thrombus load is decreasing, they are putting the stent after 24 to 48 hours.
In this patient, what is the response of thrombolysis you will expect? Nothing.
It is a
patient comes after 6, 8, 12 hours, right? He is already into high risk. So thrombolysis under jain aap mein hoge to suna hai. So then, what is to be done?
The
so
first
the data if you see, after doing procedure, the mortality still increases at 1 year. But after data,
it
if
is
you
not
know,
increasing. It is not increasing.
It was increasing that one of the high risk group, na? Go
yes.
In previous slide.
Yes, yes.
It was increasing. Change you got there.
Right.
Are you see? In high risk Cadillac score, right? In after procedure it is on higher side, or at 1 year it is on higher side. That is what you are saying. So even if you don't do, then what is the data?
Actually, that need to be there.
It must be there.
No, sir. Actually, they moral kind of moral responsibility or pattern. They haven't studied like that. If you don't do, they are not doing any follow-up. They have studied differ. In the differ protocol, they are affected, means they are not putting stent in the FFR guided angiography. And there are another trials are also, if you are not putting stent or the late putting of the stent.
A direction jama. A score ni andar, ema any point note nathi, ke jo aapne procedure na kari hai, to 1 year pachi no je pelo che, you almost same re che, vadhi jai che, ghatelo re che, kai yu ama nathi, right?
Yeah.
Okay, but, yeah. Jo mode, okay.
Question is same,
that
tamare karu
jo hai ki nahi karu jo hai.
Exactly.
That is very clear.
Once you are sure that the major damage is already been occurred, is there any indication to open vessel?
Actually, sir, there are two hypotheses. One is the open artery hypothesis. Means there are two groups in the cardiologists have for this question specifically. And this same question arises while operating the CTO, chronic total occlusion.
Exactly.
There are two groups of the cardiologists. One is preferring open artery hypothesis. Means they are giving argument if artery is open, that will give collateral to the another segment.
There is something called reperfusion injury as well. In this acute care settings, this thing that you are saying is doesn't matter.
Yes.
You are talking about chronic. Now we are into acute setting.
Yes.
Okay, એટલે હું આવી ગયો છું, હું ફેલિયર માં છું, કાર્ડિયોલોજી શોક છું, 12-15 કલાક જતી રહી છે, હવે શું જવાબ આપશું? ચાલો કરી રાખ્યું બરાબર, પણ સાયન્ટિફિકલી શું આપણી પાસે આવે તો આપણે તો કરવાનું જ હોય, અમે કોઈ ના ના પાડવાની, બટ વોટ ઇઝ ધ ઇન્ડિકેશન?
સાયન્ટિફિકલી ધે આર સ્ટેલિંગ ડિપેન્ડિંગ ઓન ધ રીનલ કન્ડિશન એન્ડ ધ ઓલ ઓવર બીપી મીન્સ ઓલ ઓવર કન્ડિશન ફોર ધ હાઈ રિસ્ક પેશન્ટ ગાઈડલાઈન ઓર ધ ACS ગાઈડલાઈન એન્ડ ESC ગાઈડલાઈન આર સેઇંગ ધેટ ઇફ STMI comes with any cardiogenic shock, we are not thinking about the prognosis, we are just putting stent. And the primary or ischemia related artery is primary preferred, means only one artery is open, another segment or another disease.
There is no advantage.
We don't know
advantage, right?
We don't know advantage because they do not
have તમારી પાસે આવી
જાય એટલે ધેન આઈ થિંક બીજો જે એક્સ્ટ્રે પાકા છે હવે તારો જૂનો લેક્ચર બી અમે એડ કરીએ તો યુ જસ્ટ સ્ટેબિલાઇઝ પેશન્ટ મેડિકલી પુનિતભાઈ આઈસીયુ માં સ્ટેબલ કરે તમે ઓપીડી માં સ્ટેબલ કરો ધેન આફ્ટર 6 ટુ 8 વીક્સ યુ કેન ગો ફોર વાયબિલિટી એન્ડ ધેન ડિસાઇડ ઇઝ ઇટ પોસિબલ કે આવું કઈ ના કરીએ આપણે
એક્ચ્યુઅલી ધેટ ઇઝ ડિપેન્ડિંગ ઓન ધ ટાઈમ વિન્ડો પેશન્ટ ને મિસ ઇફ ઇટ ઇઝ આઉટ
એક્યુટ માં લાવ્યો તો તારી પાસે પણ બીજા દિવસે આવ્યો Yeah. આ તે ત્રણ ચાર સ્કોર હતા એ કે માં સુગર એટ એટ સેવન એચ બી વન સી કે એ રોલ જ નથી બસ
એ તો એક્ચ્યુઅલી મોસ્ટ
ઇમ્પોર્ટન્ટ બીજી વસ્તુ તું જેટલા પેશન્ટ કરે છે એ કે માં સ્કોર તો તું જોતો નથી કે એ લખે છે પોઈન્ટ સમજાવે છે
એટલે રિસ્ક કેપિટલ માં આપણે આગળ સ્ટાર્ટ જોઈએ
રિસ્ક એક્સપ્લેન કરીએ
but that is mutual ke ha jo aavu aavu che je obvious point che apne we never put this on paper oh bhai Cadillac score atla aasa che ema aavelo to we never put it on diagnosis right
now risk assessment in the NSTMI the first case is 56 year old female intermittent chest pain for 2 weeks and increased in last 6 hours heart rate 90 respirator 40 RS bilateral ID, no crepitations, BP and there is no history of the EM, hypertension and hypercholesterol. ECG almost no STD changes, no major STD changes.
अरे आप इस समय अगर कोई उत्तावार नहीं करें शांति की बदबू करवा दो सांप खा दो
तब पर फिर आप NSTM में प्रूफ तो था तो सर डाला तो क्या प्रूफ देता था
सर प्रूफ करें कि स्कोर पर आएंगे छे
प्रोफाइल वो पाई क्या है ना हाउ यू जैसे डेटो जैसे पाई
अजू डिसेक्ट करो सर आउट हो बेटर पर नहीं होगा case 2 46 year old male 72 somewhat stable but the only specific thing is chest pain for 24 hours and the history of the hypertension IHD status was PTCA and the smoking here is the ECG significant ST depression in 3 AVF and there is a Q wave in V1 V2 V3 this was previous PTCA to LAD was done previous interval
પાછળ ને સેટ દે આ મત હાર્ટ રેટ 78 લખ્યા છે અભી ECG માં જો છે
ECG માં સર
મોર ધેન 100 આવો વાલે લા
98
છે હાર્ટ રેટ છે તો જોઈ લે એને ભૂલ ના રહે છે કે નહીં
પણ ચાલો તરાલીસ કરવા હાર્ટ રેટ નથી ઘટતા આપણે
ઠીક છે એને
સ્ટેમે હાર્ટ રેટ નથી ઘટતા
હા પણ યાર તું પ્રેઝન્ટેશન માં 78 બોલ ને ECG માં 110 તો કેવું ચાલે
Brunner classification for NSTMI or unstable angina. The class 1 is the new onset of the severe angina or accelerated angina, no rest pain. Class 2 is angina at rest with past month but not within preceding 48 hours at rest or subacute onset. And the class 3 is the angina at rest with 48 hours. Here, the mortality or the death or MI in 1 year. So for Class 1 it is 7.3, class 2 is 10.3 and class 3 is 10.8. Another increased risk factor, history, more advanced age, diabetes, the post-MI infraction and prior vascular disease, ECG, ST segment deviation more than 0.05, T-wave inversion more than 0.3 and LVV. Angiographic risk factor is thrombus or multivessel disease. Then clinical presentation either class 2 class 3. Brunner class 2 or class 3 suggests you the high risk of the developing any further ischemic event. Heart failure or hypotension and multiple episode of the pain at the within 24 hours. Cardiac markers increased troponin, increased CRP, increased BNP and inhibited creatinine. Thingy score for the unstable angina. Age more than 65, prior known CAD, more than 3 coronary risk factors, hypertension, alcohol, diabetes, and current smoker, aspirin use, ST segment deviation, and more than 2 episodes of angina with 24 hours, abnormal cardiac markers. Low risk 0.0 to 2 factor, 2 factors, intermediate 4 to 3, and high risk 5 to 7. In this TIMI score, they are not specifying the mortality at 1 year or 1 month. They are just, they are giving the idea or means any risk stratification in unstable angina. They are giving advice about the further management, either going early invasive strategy or we can going to late invasive or the we can delay strategy. We can have delayed strategy. The heart scoring system, history, highly suspicious means the type 2, type 3 type of angina. ECG significant ST depression, age more than 65 and age less than 45, risk factor more than 3 risk factors or no atherosclerosis disease. Troponin more than thrice normal limit. Again, low risk mortality at 1 year or the risk of developing any cardiac event at 1 year is 0.9, intermediate 12% and high risk 65%. Risk score.
Yeah, what was that risk? 65% so?
Developing any cardiac event, they are not specific to mortality, developing further cardiac event, means developing STMI. Or the developing myocardial dysfunction.
Okay, what time do you have the occasion?
1 year.
1 year.
Here we can see the heart score is more specific in the prognosis about the any, means any, giving idea about the developing any further cases of the CV myocardial morbidity. What's the last slide? Make the last slide also. Immediate imaging, if there is a high risk, there is a general idea. If there is a high risk patient which carries the very high mortality or morbidity MACE rate, immediate invasive strategy is preferred. It's still a guided strategy in low risk patient. If there is a TIMI score 0 or 1 and troponin negative patient, we can give low risk patient. If there is a gradual worsening or after the second or third sample of the troponin is elevated or any new ECG changes, after that we will go in the invasive strategy. Till then we can wait as per the guide. Early invasive within the 24 hours and delayed invasive within 24 to 72 hours. So delayed invasive, we can say if patient is stable. In this patient, if patient is stable but there is a risk factor, reduce LV systolic function, early infraction, early post-infraction angina, which within 6 months of last procedure, PCI within 6 months, prior CAV, if there is a previous CAV, or the grace risk score 109 to 140, or TIMI score more than 2. In this patient, delayed invasive strategy is preferred.
Will you subject any of this stable patient to treatment test or stress test before deciding PCI?
Sir, actually stress test is preferred, but it is different. We are coming to that also. Stress test and discharge and next. If in STMI patient, they are telling, the guideline is saying clearly, in low risk patient and the intermediate risk patient, we can do stress test before discharge. Or before, means after treating the OPD basis at 14 days or after means 7 to 14 days. But if there is a high risk patient like the post PCI or post CABG and having angina, although there is no ECG changes, although there is troponin negative, but stress test may lead to plaque rupture or high risk, very high risk. So developing MACE during stress test is high. So better to go with angiography than doing the stress test.
So what are the clinical selection criteria? To whom you will subject for stress test?
Sorry sir?
Clinical selection criteria. Can stress test karao or not karao?
Again, there is
a high risk state nahi karao?
High risk much. They are saying it is high risk. They are calculate to, means they are asking to calculate the SUDI score and the high risk feature. If the ST depression is more than 2 mm and if there is a borderline troponin positive, if there is a gradual increase in the anginal pain, means last 48 hours gradually increasing anginal pain or ongoing anginal pain. In this patient, we are not preferred to do stress test. So first case, the TIMI score is 0, heart score is 1. In second state, TIMI score is 5, heart score is 9. So our inference is better to go with angiography in high TIMI score or the high heart score. So in the second step, we prefer to go with the angiography or the invasive strategy. And case 1, we can go with medical management.